Thanks to everyone for joining us today for this installment of the BCPs, the Balcones Canyonlands Preserves Wild Neighbors Speaker Series. So this is a collaboration between us. I'm Audrey Stewart, the volunteer coordinator for Austin Water Wildland Conservation and Travis County Natural Resources. So we often get questions from preserve neighbors and other members of the community about topics related to wildlife and wild lands. This series is an opportunity for us to discuss some of those topics with an expert and also share some ways that folks can live alongside the preserve and our wild neighbors and also support our local ecosystems and wildlife. So thanks for being here. So just a brief introduction to the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve. This is a map of the preserve. It's a network of preserves that's managed by multiple partners. The City of Austin and Travis County manage the Endangered Species Permit that enabled the formation of the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve. And the Habitat Conservation Plan that enabled this preserve provides an umbrella of protection for a number of endangered and rare species. So the golden-cheeked warbler and black-capped vireo, migratory songbirds, six cave dwelling invertebrates that are endangered, and also 27 other species of concern. So this is just a map showing where the endangered species habitat is in West Austin, and showing that the preserve, along with the wildlife refuge, which is different but same name and related, protects about 30% of the highest quality closed canopy woodlands for endangered species habitat, while allowing 70% of the remaining habitat to be developed. So by mitigating for development, the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve allows the City of Austin to grow and prosper while protecting our most sensitive species, and therefore many other species as well. So there's many ways to get to know the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve. You might already know and enjoy places you didn't even know were part of the preserve. So Hamilton Pool, Mount Bunnell, some really beautiful spaces. We also have lots of volunteer opportunities and guided hikes in parts of the preserve that aren't regularly open to the public. Right now, we've paused these activities due to the pandemic, but I'm gonna put some links in the chat to our website so that you can stay in touch. And once we have these opportunities, you can come back out. We'd love to have you join us. So before I turn it over to Darrell, just a couple of items of business. So we're gonna be posting a recording of this presentation on our Facebook event. I'll post a link to that in our chats. So feel free to share with anyone you think might be interested. Watch it again if you couldn't get enough. I'm also gonna share a link to a document we created with some native plant alternatives for common invasive plants, as well as some, it'll include links to more information about Texas invasives, Texas native plants, some planting tips and more info like that. And finally, with Zoom, we have a Q&A function now. So Jeremy Hull, the volunteer coordinator for Travis County, is going to be emceeing a Q&A session with Darrell after the talk. So please put your questions into that Q&A function instead of in the comments section, and he'll be able to address your question. So for those who aren't familiar with Zoom, I recommend setting your screen to speaker view instead of gallery view. That option's usually in the top right corner of your screen. So now I'm gonna turn it over to Darrell Hutchinson. So we're lucky to have Darrell today. He's a biologist for the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve with the City of Austin. Darrell, thanks for being here today to talk about the ecology of invasives. So now I'm gonna turn it over to your screen.
The ecology of invasives. The Balcones Canyonland Preserve protects a diverse ecosystem that supports endangered birds, karst invertebrates, and many rare plants. As preserve managers, our job is to promote a healthy ash, juniper, oak forest community. One of our management goals is to control invasive species. Understanding the ecology of invasives is important to meeting this conservation objective. Invasive species are plants and animals that are non-native, meaning they come from somewhere else, and cause harm to native ecosystems. Most introduced plants and animals are not invasive. For example, Roses and begonias are ornamentals commonly placed in gardens but do not survive in the wild. Other non-natives like dandelions or the monk parakeets flying around downtown Austin have become naturalized in our urban landscapes but don't adversely impact our natural landscapes. However, Japanese honeysuckle, feral hogs, and red imported fire ants have all disrupted native ecosystems. Only about 1% of all non-native species introductions ever become invasive. So how does an introduced species go from being an ornamental to becoming invasive? There's nothing insidious about the nature of an invasive species. Invasive plants and animals are simply adapting a common weedy growth strategy to a new environment. Weedy species are fast-growing and relatively short-lived. For example, annual wildflowers race to maturity in order to produce as many seeds as possible and then die, all in one growing season. Weedy species have rapid reproductive strategies, but invest little energy into any one of their progeny. For example, the female mosquito fish gives birth nearly constantly to independent live young, and she can store sperm. So if a lone female arrives in a new pond, she can populate the entire water body. Alternatively, slow growth species play the long game. Oak trees, for example, take years to reach maturity, and even then, some species only produce acorns during mast years. Other slow growth species, like elephants, have long gestation periods, produce only one or two young at a time, and have a long-term parental care. Weedy plants and animals are generally fast-growing, short-lived, reproduce lots of offspring rapidly that can sometimes travel long distances. Weediness is not pejorative in this case. It simply describes a common growth and reproductive strategy. Many of our native species are weedy generalists too, like poverty weed, yellow wood sorrel, and even Virginia possum. Virginia opossums inhabit all of Texas wherever there's water and eat a large variety of food. They produce 2 litters annually and up to 12 young, and adults rarely live beyond 2 years. Both native and non-native weedy species tend to colonize areas that are recently disturbed. It's called species assemblage. The first species to establish can dominate, at least for a while. Flooding, wildfire, and tree falls are natural causes of disturbance. Wildfire reduces competition by inhibiting the establishment of woody trees and shrubs. Low-intensity ground fires increase nutrient availability on the surface, which then results in a fire flush of new growth. Riparian areas are dynamic ecosystems driven by a regular influx of surface runoff and soil deposition. When extreme flooding occurs, it levels the playing field to create open space and resources for fast-growing weedy species to colonize. Treefall gaps are not very significant here because our primary forests were cut down. However, in existing old-growth forests, treefalls create huge gaps that allow sunlight to penetrate to the forest floor, stimulating seedlings to race to the canopy. Human disturbance such as development, off-road vehicle use, and resource extraction has sharply increased the amount of space and opportunity for weedy species to establish. As the human population increases, we can anticipate more rapid land use change, which can favor the growth of exotics even over local weedy species. Many invasive species depend upon human-modified landscapes and are known as human commensals. Human commensals tend not to invade natural landscapes, but track our expansion into natural environments. The house mouse and Eurasian house sparrow are good examples. So how do invasives get imported? Well, we can divide arrivals into two categories, accidental and intentional introductions. Intentional introductions can be for fun, such as ornamental plants or even birds. For example, European starlings were introduced into Central Park, New York City in 1890 by Shakespeare enthusiasts who wanted America to have every bird that the bard mentioned. Historically, many species were introduced around the world for food and forage. Pigs were brought here by the first Spanish explorers in the 16th century and went feral immediately. In the 1930s, wild boars were introduced into Texas for sport hunting, and then the boars interbred with the feral hogs. Benjamin Franklin shipped seeds of the Chinese tallow tree to Georgia for use as a source of oil. Even today, non-native blue-stem grasses and buffle grass are planted for forage. Many species are introduced by government for erosion control or pest management. For example, ice plant was introduced into Southern California from South Africa, which has a very similar climate. Ice plant is very effective at stabilizing soil, but it outcompetes natives, alters soil composition, and now threatens many endemic species of coastal California. Some invasive species have a long and interesting history as commodities. For example, cochineal is a plant sucking scale insect that produces a white waxy substance to confuse predators. The host plant of cochineal is the prickly pear cactus native to the Americas. The indigenous peoples of Mexico use the body fluid of cochineal to produce a red dye known as carmine. The introduction of carmine to the old world by the Spanish revolutionized the dye-making industry because cochineal could be used to produce bright reds, oranges, and yellows. The Spanish controlled a lucrative trade market for almost two centuries until eventually the cactus and the scale insect were exported. As a result, prickly pear cactus is now a terrible invasive all over Australia and Africa. Accidental introductions typically occur through the transportation of people and goods. Examples include tiger mosquitoes, earthworms, probably cheatgrass, not to mention human diseases like influenza, smallpox, measles, and typhus fever. Black rats infested Jamestown, Virginia in the 1600s. Zebra mussels are brought to the Great Lakes in ship's ballast. Brown tree snake, Chinese blight arrived with the importation of Japanese chestnut trees. Brown tree snakes arrived in Guam as stowaways on military aircraft. The Burmese pythons that now infest the Florida Everglades were originally brought here as pets, and they weren't a huge problem until so many escaped during Hurricane Andrew. Intentional introductions tend to be charismatic vertebrates and plants. Unintentional introductions are often nondescript invertebrates and microorganisms. So why is it that some non-native weedy species remain benign while others become invasive? First, the advantage that introduced species have over native species is the absence in their new home of their native predators, parasites, diseases, and competitors. Predators, parasites, and disease play an important role in maintaining ecological balance. Released from these population controls, non-native plants and animals gain an advantage over native species and can outcompete them for essential resources. For example, tamarisk or salt cedar is native to the Middle East. It's very drought resistant and sends down long taproots. It was first introduced to control windblown sand and later adopted for windbreaks and erosion control. When the Federal Bureau of Reclamation fundamentally changed the hydrology of the Western US by damming all the rivers, tamarisk was already established and poised to take the place of the native willows and cottonwood. In the old world, 325 species of insects and mites munch on the tamarisk, which effectively keeps its growth in check. One species, the so-called tamarisk beetle, has proven to be a very successful biocontrol because it devours leaves at every life stage. Not surprisingly, the tamarisk beetle has nowhere near the same effect on tamarisk in the old world because there, the beetle's population is partially controlled by a parasitic wasp, which is absent here in North America. The second advantage that introduced species have over native species is repeated introductions. For example, glossy privet, Ligustrum lucidum, was first introduced into the US from Japan and Korea in 1794. It was widely planted as an ornamental tree and hedgerow plant. In Austin, during the 60s and 70s, it was one of the few plants available in the nurseries to landscape your garden. Over time, it escaped, established, spread like crazy, and now is very difficult to eradicate. Reaching a critical population threshold is essential to becoming invasive. Some invasive species established through multiple introductions via repurposing. King Ranch and the Clayburgh bluestem grasses were originally brought in to serve as forage for cattle during drought conditions. It's not very nutritious and the cows don't much care for it. However, it does grow well. So TxDOT later adopted it for a few years during the 50s and 60s and sowed it along the Texas highways for erosion control. Are invasive species really all that bad? Yes. A single introduction can result in native species extinctions and alter the ecology of an ecosystem. Zebra mussels reached North America in the mid-1980s in the ballast water of a ship. They rapidly became established in the Great Lakes and all the waters draining them. They are very efficient filter feeders, which means that they filter small organisms and organic particles out of the water. These phytoplankton and zooplankton form the base of the aquatic food web on which many other animals depend. Zebra mussels have overrun the native mussels and starve the open water fish. And because of their three-stage reproductive cycle, they're almost impossible to eradicate. Every year, a mature female zebra mussel releases up to 1 million eggs, while the male releases more than 200 million sperm. In 2 days, the fertilized eggs developed into free-swimming larvae called veligers, which can travel long distances in the water currents. The adults will cling to almost any surface and can survive out of the water for up to 21 days, which means they can travel across the country on a boat or trailer. In 2019, zebra mussels were detected in Lake Austin. Solenopsis invicta, or the red imported fire ant, arrived in Mobile, Alabama in the 1930s, also possibly in the ballast of a cargo ship. Today, it infests 260 million acres of crops, pastures, parks, and suburban neighborhoods, and causes an estimated $6.7 billion worth of damage annually. Red imported fire ants can dominate a terrestrial landscape to the point where a lizard or a mouse can't rest for more than 20 minutes at a time before the fire ants find them. Fire ants spread so rapidly because of a lack of predators, parasites, and pathogens, and live at greater density than they would in their native land because of a change in social structure. Normally, the workers of two different ant colonies defend territories and behave aggressively towards one another because their queens are genetically different. However, the red imported fire ant here have formed polygyne or multi-queen super colonies where all the workers recognize each other as sisters. This may have occurred because their arrival in the US was a single founding event and they're all related to the original queen. In 1990, a study conducted here in Austin at Brackenridge Field Laboratory found that fire ants reduced the number of native ants by 90%, the number of non-ant arthropods by 75%, and the overall number of arthropod species by 40%. Interestingly, in a follow-up study conducted 12 years later, much of the ant and arthropod species diversity had recovered, although fire ants were still by far the most abundant ant. Which begs the question, can what was once an invasive species become naturalized over time? Well, yes, but this time scale is very long. For example, 3 million years ago, a land bridge formed connecting North and South America at the Isthmus of Panama. Cats, dogs, rodents, and weasels invaded South America and wiped out all the marsupial carnivores and large herbivores. 4,000 years ago, dingoes were introduced into Australia. Dingoes are pack hunting canids and had a significant impact on the native marsupials and are implicated in the mainland extinction of Tasmanian devil and thylacine. Presently, any surviving prey species will have learned to fear and avoid dingoes, so in that sense, it is naturalized. Ecosystems are dynamic. Plants and animals are expanding and contracting their ranges all the time. But the scale of change has become so vast and rapid that devastating perturbations are occurring more and more frequently. Pictured are three non-native invertebrates. We don't really even think of as invasive because they're so ubiquitous in our gardens. Earthworms are good, right? They stir up the soil, making nutrients more accessible to my flowers and vegetables. Well, European earthworms took advantage of an empty niche. Native earthworms were all but disappeared during the Pleistocene Ice Age. A few species survived in the southern US. New species of earthworms arrived in North America in the 1600s with the first European settlers. European earthworms thrived in the upper soils of forests and gardens, while the native earthworms, if there were any, remained deeper underground. The traits that make earthworms wonderful for gardens are the same ones that make them dangerous to forests. Our northern forests, in particular, evolved without earthworms and accumulate huge amounts of leaf litter. When Eurasian earthworm species invade, they munch and turn over all this organic debris, driving nutrients deeper into the soil where they're no longer available to young native plants and tree saplings. And because earthworms convert nutrients into easier to access forms, they can facilitate the introduction of invasive plants. Earthworms may redeem themselves in the face of climate change. As earthworms chew and churn up the soil, researchers suspect they may have some impact on the forest's ability to store carbon, but we don't know yet. Which begs the next question. Are there instances when non-native or even invasive species can be useful in a natural environment? In general, non-native species cause the loss of biological diversity. However, in some cases, they can also provide conservation benefits. They can provide habitat for endangered species, serve as functional substitutes for extinct taxa, and provide desirable ecosystem functions in highly modified habitats. For example, the endangered southwest willow flycatcher now nests in tamarisk instead of willow trees, and some studies show that their reproductive success is similar. In Mauritius, an introduced tortoise now provides the same seed dispersal functions for native plants that an extinct tortoise once did. In Puerto Rico, some former pastures are so degraded they no longer support native tree species, whereas non-native plantation trees can survive and eventually facilitate native tree restoration. Non-native species can help achieve conservation goals in the future because they may be more likely than native species to persist and provide ecosystem services in areas where climate and land use are changing rapidly. Let me take a pause. So, are we overreacting to this whole invasive species issue? Well, there are voices in conservation biology that argue the whole problem of invasive species is overblown. It's a hopeless battle and a waste of valuable resources. Most introduced species are not problematic. In some instances, introduced species increase biodiversity. The antipathy towards introduced species is xenophobic. In the face of rapid globalization and climate change, we cannot substantially slow the spread of invasions anyways, so let's embrace these novel environments. Look at this abandoned lot in Chicago. Instead of spending tens of thousands of dollars on trying to establish a native plant garden, let's just allow the invaders to take over. In a few years, there'll be flowers and bushes and bees and bugs, so who cares if all the species originated in Eurasia? Heck, my ancestors arrived here on a boat from Eurasia. Yes, humans are a weedy species and we perpetuate the problem. But if we don't take action to prevent the spread of invasive species, we'll be living on a planet full of weeds. We'll McDonaldize the natural world and the loss of biodiversity will threaten ecosystem function. To help us understand how species adapt to new and changing environments, let's think about organisms along a simplified gradient of specialists versus generalists. Specialists occupy niches that provide them with exclusive access to resources. Specialists may be adapted to harsh environments and/or co-evolved with other species. For example, the sword-billed hummingbird drinks nectar from passion flowers with long tubular corollas. In its cloud forest habitat, there are many other hummingbird species and many different kinds of flowers, but the swordbill enjoys almost exclusive access to these long tubular corollas because of its bill. Larval monarch butterflies are able to sequester the toxic alkaloids contained in milkweed plants that are so noxious they deter almost all other herbivores. The larvae enjoy exclusive access to milkweeds, and the adults are able to manifest toxins that make them unpalatable to butterfly predators. Polar bears eat anything that moves, but live in an extremely harsh environment. Specialists are very well adapted to their specified habitat, but cannot easily export these adaptations when rapid changes occur. Generalists, on the other hand, tend to be weedy, but not necessarily associated with disturbance. Generalists have a wide physiological tolerance with a diverse diet and diverse habitat preferences, including human-modified habitats. For example, white-tailed deer range from Canada to Bolivia and occupy practically every habitat in between. American crow is a very social, smart, omnivorous corvid found in every habitat from the boreal forest to the Florida Keys. The annual wildflower Indian blanket is now found across the US. It's not fussy about soil types, not picky about pollinators, and as a result has been adopted by the nursery trade and is very popular in Europe. As an example of how an invasive generalist can impact native specialists, let's consider the European honeybee. The honeybee can be found on every continent except Antarctica. It was introduced into the Americas in the 1600s. Although it is one of only a few bee species that produce honey, its main value is as a pollinator. The honeybee has been domesticated because it's not selective about what flowers it will visit. For the agricultural industry, they provide a pollination service to commercial crops. Honeybee hives are trucked around the country and released in fields and orchards to pollinate everything from almonds and alfalfa to cucumbers and kale. Modern food production could not function without them, which is why there is so much concern about colony collapse disorder. It's not because they're rare, it's because overpopulation of honeybees and being treated as a commodity has resulted in a host of stressors affecting colony health. There's an estimated 20,000 species of bee. Many are still undescribed. Many are rare and localized. Many have already gone extinct. In contrast, honeybees are everywhere, and their effect on native species has been immense. Many plants have co-evolved with a suite of specialized pollinators. Some of these pollinators are solitary bees that live as larvae and pupa much of the year underground. These specialist bees time their emergence with the flowering of their host plant and then travel miles to pollinate each and every one, which for rare plants helps guarantee their successful reproduction over a broad area, even at low population density. When honeybees invade, the process is disrupted. When the solitary bee emerges and locates its host plant, it may find that nectar and pollen resources are already depleted. And since the honeybees are going from flower to flower between all the different species of plants, they may never cross-pollinate the rare plants at all. In this way, the honeybees swamp out all the specialist pollinators, sometimes driving them to extinction. And they promote the distribution of common plants over less common and scarcely distributed native plants. What's more, honeybees actually facilitate the expansion of invasives by pollinating non-native plants that the native pollinators wouldn't touch. This is called the invasion meltdown hypothesis. The presence of invasive species encourages the spread and establishment of other invasive species by introducing multiple stressors to natives. So, are non-native weeds invading everywhere? No. Biodiverse, stable ecosystems are the most resilient to perturbations. The Western Amazon is the most biologically diverse place on the planet. It's old. It's big. And although there is natural disturbance in terms of tree falls and rivers, there are relatively few species that are weedy, and they are commonly observed along the rivers. Instead, the majority of species are relatively specialized, long-lived, and quite rare. And they're all packed together on top of one another. For example, most of the ant shrike species on this color plate can be found in a single location in lowland rainforest Peru. Now, how can this be when the behavior and morphology of all these insect-eating birds is the same? It's called niche partitioning. Each species lives in a particular microhabitat within the rainforest. One species likes river edge, another likes interior streams. One species occupies the canopy, another prefers the understory. One likes flooded forest, another likes terra firma. And because all these ecological niches are so densely occupied, outside species can't penetrate. Intact, diverse ecosystems are resilient to intrusions. Of course, if you cut down the forest, the whole system collapses. So what does this have to do with Central Texas? Well, our forests are not old or stable. They were clear cut during the cedar chopping era, beginning in the 1880s. Decades of ranching and now increased development have left many landscapes degraded and vulnerable to invasions. Repairing degraded ecosystems is the science of restoration ecology, and restoration guides much of the work we do at Wildlands Conservation Division. So, how can we control invasive species? The effective control of invasive species is a three-pronged approach. Preventative measures. Government plays a role in identifying and restricting the movement of invasive species, but their interest is in protecting industry. Aquatic species get more attention than terrestrial species. However, terrestrial invasive species that do not impact agriculture, ranching, or hunting are generally not restricted. Special interest groups likely play a role. For example, the nursery trade very much values plants that are fast growing, reproduce rapidly, and are resistant to local pests and diseases. Several plants that we control on the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve, including privet, heavenly bamboo or nandina, and chinaberry are not included on the TIXAS list of noxious species. Vigilance. Increased trade and transport of commodities around the world is a principal driver of future spread. Border inspections are critical. Unfortunately, although APHIS, our Federal Animal and Plant Inspection Service, spends tens of millions of dollars on eradication of invasive species, their vigilance at the border is less well funded. If you Google US government biosecurity, the first organism mentioned is anthrax, which gives you an indication of what the focus has become. Eradication is something we've become much better at. The challenge is to remove the invasive species and prevent recolonization. Depending on where and what kind of organism you're dealing with, this can involve a series of different methods. Localized invasions of plants lend themselves very well to physical removal. Depending on the scale, it might look like a bulldozer or a group of volunteers with weed wrenches. However, in both cases, plant removal results in soil disturbance, so a restoration plan is typically required to revegetate with appropriate native species that can successfully compete with the next wave of invaders. Depending on natural ecosystem processes, if you're managing for a prairie or savanna, for example, you might introduce prescribed fire followed by seeding. The use of toxic chemicals is controversial, but targeted use has been shown to be very effective. For example, New Zealand is a poster child for the havoc wrought by invasive species. For millennia, it was an island of small lizards and flightless birds. Since humans arrived and land mammals were introduced 750 years ago, the number of native vertebrate species has nearly halved. At least 51 species of bird have disappeared. Now, using traps, aerial baits, and species-specific poisons, New Zealand conservationists have successfully eradicated every single stoat, fox, cat, rat, and brush-tailed possum from several smaller islands. The New Zealand government has decided to expand and fund the program nationwide with a project called Predator Free 2050. Biological controls work by introducing a predator, parasite, or pathogen that we know acts as a population control on the invading species in its natural landscape. Great care must be taken to ensure that the newly introduced species does not jump hosts. Years ago, the red fox was introduced to Australia to control exploding populations of the introduced rabbit. The foxes predated on rabbits, but also predated on native marsupials. The Indian mongoose was introduced to the New World, including Hawaii, to control rat infestations. Mongoose do eat rats, but they're opportunistic and also eat birds. Also problematic is the fact that mongoose are diurnal, while rats are not nocturnal. So now the birds in Hawaii are threatened by both rats and mongoose. This is why any potential biological control must go through years of testing to ensure it will have no unanticipated impacts. Biological controls work in many interesting ways. Here in Texas, our ecosystem has been ravaged by red imported fire ants. Hundreds of thousands of tons of pesticides have been applied with little effect to the overall population. Meanwhile, fire ants have devastated populations of native ground nesting birds and lizards, including bobwhite and Texas horned lizards. Scientists from UT Austin traveled to Argentina to discover what biological mechanism controlled fire ant populations there. They discovered a parasitic fly known as a forid. Female forid flies are attracted to fire ants swarming over a mound or foraging trail. They hover over the ants until a target is chosen, then dart in, inject an egg into the ant's body, and fly away. The injected egg develops in the ant's thorax, then the larva moves into the head, the ant's head drops off, and the adult fly emerges about 45 days later. The number of infected ants in a single colony is only around 1%, so direct mortality has little impact on colony growth. But the forage success is a biocontrol is how they alter the colony's behavior. As forages fly above the ants looking for victims, the ants respond by running around, retreating into the nest, and posturing in various ways. It's the forage fly's harassment that disrupts the fire ants from provisioning their nest and defending their home. Meanwhile, native ant species can take advantage of the fire ants' distraction and reclaim resources and lost territory. Now, a dual result has been launched against the RIFA. A disease organism called a microsporidia was discovered to infect red imported fire ants. It's transmitted by infected ants to other infected ants, to other ants within and between colonies, and can severely impact colony health and size. Best of all, the forage flies can act as a vector for the microsporidia. In fact, it's a microsporidia that has proven most successful in limiting the spread of our most recent ant invader, the tawny crazy ant. So how do we manage our preserve lands? Well, except for controlling fire ants and tawny crazy ants near cave entrances, most of the invasive species we address are plants. Developing identification skills is key. You don't necessarily have to memorize all the Latin names, but you need to gain a sense of what's the same and what's different. The best way to prevent and contain invasions is early detection and rapid response. Minimizing seed transport is often a matter of awareness. For example, in Southern California, researchers change footwear whenever they travel between high desert and low desert study sites to prevent the spread of weed seeds. Minimizing soil disturbance is best done by using the proper equipment and following up with revegetation. And most importantly, plant a native Texan. Lots of them. Diversity creates stability, and stable environments are more resilient. If you want to help out or learn more about restoration on a preserve, talk to Audrey about volunteering. What can you do at home? Well, at my house, we converted our suburban lawn to a garden celebrating the Texas Hill Country. The first step was to identify all the native and non-native plants. We removed the crepe myrtle trees and the pampas grass. We killed the St. Augustine by turning off the turf sprinklers during the 2011 drought. I experimented with both leaving and removing the dead sod and discovered that digging up the sod created more disturbance and germinated more weed seeds. We planted and seeded over 150 native species. We collected seed from gardens and highway medians and purchased seeds from the Wildlife Center and the Native Plant Society of Texas plant sale events. We established a rain garden, a shade garden, and a pollinator garden. We installed a rainwater collection system and built bee houses. We try to manage light conditions for full sun, partial sun, and full shade to increase the diversity of plants we can grow. We control weeds by maintaining vigilance and identifying all newcomers. Several native plants have volunteered, like evergreen sumac, bumelia, and frostweed, which we've nurtured. However, most are unwanted forbs and grasses like chickweed, scarlet pimpernel, Asian hawksbeard, fern grass, and lots of legustrum seedlings. We also remove weedy natives like spurge and wood sorrel because they can just take over. In terms of invasive animal species, we target rats and snails with non-toxic baits and pour water, boiling water on fire ant mounds. We now host about 12 species of native ants, several species of reptiles, and there are birds feeding in the yard almost all the time. Thank you.
All right, that was good. A lot of great information in there that I picked up there, Darrell.
Thank you.
We do have several questions in the Q&A here, and if anyone else has any other questions, feel free to start populating that, and we'll go until we run out of time or everything gets answered. So first off, the first question here, back at the very beginning when you were talking about prickly pear and its impacts, is what are the actual impacts of prickly pear on the places that has it invaded? Do you know?
I think similar to what you might see in some of the pasture lands here in the hill country, is that nothing eats prickly pear, and they just are able to spread everywhere. So you just see big, you know, mounds of it. So I think the impacts are just occupation and.
Okay, cool. Next was, how is the damage calculated by fire ants that you mentioned? Like, what is the damage calculated indicating that you were talking about at the very beginning?
Oh, the $1 billion of damage. That's a good question, because, you know, I just kind of copied that. I imagine it's probably lost revenue and also expenses in pesticide control.
Yeah, I was thinking pesticides would be a big mm-hmm. cause in that.
Mm-hmm. Cost of pesticide and lost revenue in terms of crop damage and damage to livestock as well.
Cool. Okay. The next one says, I think, and they put George kudzu, but I think they were referring to Georgia kudzu is invasive. She said, it's everywhere. I've always wondered why it couldn't be used as a feed for cattle, for example.
I think it's a case of, the kudzu is a case of where it was introduced as feed, and it just escaped and went wild. So even though it might be good feed and animals like it, it can, its population can just go crazy because of lack of ecological constraints. So even though there might be a predator like a cow on it, it still doesn't have the parasites or the pathogens that would keep it in check in its native homeland.
When referring to the fire ants, it says, could you use an anteater to control fire ants, like controlling the anteaters so it doesn't impact the environment? But is that a possibility?
I think there are native anteaters in Argentina, and I imagine they do have a slight impact on the fire ants. Whenever I've observed anteaters in the Amazon eating on fire ants, they'll attack for a while until they're just getting too stung up and then move on. So they don't really impact the colony health a little bit just by disrupting it, sort of like the forage, but they don't really kill the colony. So there's that issue that, no, they probably wouldn't have that great an impact. And then the second issue, of course, is what if the anteaters just start munching on all the native ant species or other things? And this is what has happened. And something like this occurred with nutria. I believe nutria was first introduced with the thought of eating hydrilla. Hydrilla is one of those floating aquatic vegetations that were brought here from Eurasia somewhere and started taking over ponds. And somebody had the idea that nutria would work. I don't think it was a government-sponsored program. I think it was something that sort of happened. And then the nutria do eat hydrilla, but they just eat everything else too. So misguided efforts.
Yep. This next question is really good. I had the same question when you were speaking about your yard. Is do you live in an HOA? Did you have to get that approved? Have you had any pushback? Because while we think it's beautiful because we kind of know about it, the untrained eye would think, oh, that's just a, you know, overgrown kind of weedy space. But so.
Yes is the answer to all those questions. So yes, we do live in an HOA. the HOA covenants say you don't have to have a lawn, you have to have a maintained landscape. And what the neighbors observe is me going out there all the time, watering and weeding and stuff. So it's very maintained. In the height of spring, it looks beautiful and almost everybody gets it. But there's no question that there was a little bit of a transition period where the grass is ugly and there's only a few things going on in the first year where people were wondering what was going on. And then I converted them all as they saw it happen. Now people literally drive by, stop their car, jump out and go, wow, and take pictures. So now it's a polite neighborhood. So I imagine there's people who don't really like it. And I think the feedback is not that it's overgrown. It's just that there's snakes in there and things like that. You know, people have those kind of issues. And so, you know, you're harboring pests or something. So, but it's a polite neighborhood. They don't usually address that to us. So it is kind of a sea change, a gradual sea change of demonstrating to people. And that's really what it is, a demonstration garden, that you can do this too, and it's beautiful. And you don't have to do it on the scale of that I do it, because it's really a lot of work.
It is beautiful though. I think it's pretty awesome.
Thank you.
In your last comments about baits for invasive mammals, are you trapping or removing or like combination?
So the rat bait is probably the most controversial. There's a bait we purchase is called Tetra D. And the D stands for vitamin D. And it's a block, and you anchor the block down in place where you think the rats might be, you know, running by. And the rats really like vitamin D and chew on it. And it doesn't kill them quickly, but they begin to gradually overdose vitamin D. And the key to it is, or most important part, is that if any other animal eats it, which they do, they don't overdose. It's a rat thing. Also, if and when the rat actually dies and another species eats that rat, they only get a big dose of vitamin D. So it's kind of an unusual thing, and it works very effectively. The other one we use on snails is called sluggo, and there's a version of sluggo that is iron. It's basically a little pellet filled with iron. The snails love it, they eat it, they die because they overdose on iron. Anybody else eats it, they get a dose of iron, that's it. So there have been a lot of, you know, people have gotten smart about these things, a lot of money to be made, obviously. So they're finding things that can, chemicals, certain or substances, I guess, that can really affect the target species, and then they make that into a palatable package, and then you can distribute that safely in your environment.
Okay, this next one, we'll see if we can get an answer. If not, they may have to follow up with some emails, but Alex said, there's some trees growing in my yard that I see all over the neighborhood. It has a serrated leaf that are itchy, and it's a thorny tree. Roots are very deep. Says, iNaturalist hasn't been able to identify it for them. Do you have any idea what it is and what they could maybe do to get rid of it?
Photinia, maybe? Photinia has a serrated leaf. I don't know if it's thorny. Not sure.
Okay.
What can you do to get rid of it? Well, obviously dig it up if you can do that. You know, on the wildlands, we use the this pellet injector, and the pellets contain a very, very small amount of glyphosate. And you basically just inject the tree with this pellet, and glyphosate is Roundup, and it gradually kills the tree in place. Glyphosate has very little drift. And since you're injecting it right into the tree, it tends to be pretty safe. Obviously, it's tricky, and you don't want to do it when it's raining, that kind of thing. But those are usually the things that we do. Weed wrenching is always better. Even if you start to cut it down and want to do that, you kind of have to pull a little drip. It'll probably resprout, so you need to maybe apply a little bit of the glyphosate on that as a liquid. So those are the solutions. They're not easy solutions. They're always,
Right.
But I'm not sure what the tree is. I can't be sure. Pyracantha would be another guess. Pyracantha. But I don't think that has serrated leaves. So I don't really know.
Hmm. if they want to send us some pictures, we try to help out.
See, we can try to help out. A lot of people on staff who know their trees pretty well, yeah.
There were several answers about the boiling water and fire ants. As, does the boiling water work, or does it just make a move? And you just, somebody was asking, do you just pour it right on the mound, or what?
Yes, all of these type of chemical controls, or even, you know, removal, have to be targeted. The last thing you want to do is subscribe to a pest service who are going to sprinkle baits all over your yard and spray some pyrethrine solution all around the base of your house. That kills everything. So all the kind of controls that I do and that we do on the preserve too are targeted, absolutely targeted. So in terms of the fire ants, yes, boiling water right directly on the mound kills them. You need a lot. And of course you have to deal with it, you know, a kettle or two of it, but it works well. I mean, you know, it hurts them, of course, but, you know, you get rid of them. And as I've said, by controlling fire ants, you improve the, you know, you encourage the native ants. And you can really see that after a couple of years, too. So boiling water is, I think on the preserve, the we have like a machine that boils a lot of water, and you can put it in a tank and put that on your shoulder and then walk around and spray that on a tank like you would an insecticide, but it's not insecticide, it's just boiling water. It's hot work. But in your yard, of course, you can just go out there with a pot of boiling water and stick it right on them. The best time to look is after rainfall, because it they get flooded out of the soil and they start moving. So that's a good time. And it's usually just after that rainfall that they mound up. So you just give that mound just a little hit with your heel and then just dump that boiling water on there.
This next question is really good. And it's the constant battle against non-native plants is, I removed a big area of privet, then years later, the seeds that were in the soil germinate and grow up again. How do you deal with seed bank? Is it just repeated removal, you know?
Yes, and introducing the native competitors. Privet is really, really, really tricky. Yes. Yeah. So we have a spot, it's called Long Canyon. We've been going in there, pulling them out. And I think you have to go back for several years and you need to introduce seeds. And I think the seeds they're doing are different plants, but also Indian sea oats. So we'll see how that plays out. Privet is dogged, is very, very dogged. It's tricky. It's tricky. And yes, seed bank is a huge problem, which takes you back to steps about being ever vigilant. And as soon as you notice something, you go on it. And that's one of the things that we've done with the tawny crazy ants is once we became aware it was such a problem, once they arrived in Travis County, we really, really took made a measured effort to find them and try to take and to get them. And that's when they developed the microsporidia.
And then somebody in the Q&A mentioned that girdling is an effective method for small shrubs and trees, which is true. And then somebody asked, where can one buy a weed wrench?
I don't know. We'd have to follow up on that. I think you can buy them online. Mm-hmm. The tricky thing about weed wrenches is they come in different sizes. And if, you know, the little one is easy to carry, but it doesn't pull out anything really big. And the big, super big one will take out big things, but it won't take out little things because it's too big. And of course, it's real heavy to carry around. You can eliminate plants in your yard by cutting them down over and over again. I did that with crepe myrtle. And I didn't poison it. I just went after it and then it resprouted and I went after it and resprouted and dug at it again, and eventually it's gone. But you know, that's on a home landscape, that's just a yard, right? You're only looking at two or three trees.
Do you do anything to control mosquitoes?
No.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I cover up when I'm outside in my own yard. It's funny because it's ironic. You spend all this time out in the forest and mosquitoes are just not an issue. Just not an issue at all. Not for me anyway. And some people are more attractive to mosquitoes, so it varies. In my yard here in a suburban development, tons of mosquitoes all the time. There's just so much standing water and people are just not sensitive to it that the mosquitoes are really bad. So I cover up, I'm used to that, and you know, insect repellent. But in terms of using the insecticide services that spray your house, you're obviously spraying pesticides out. It's a blanket sort of treatment, and blanket treatments are bad, basically, or problematic, let's say.
Okay, this one is, how do I know if my privet is an invasive? I'm confused by all the different species. And that may play into the resources that Audrey is going to provide at the end for the common Texas invasives and things like that. But any follow-up?
To my knowledge, all the privets are introduced. I think now the nursery strain has brought in some that flower but don't fruit. So in that sense, there can't be spread. So one could have that variety, and technically that wouldn't really be a problem. It's basically a sterile privet. So a sterile privet wouldn't be a problem. But in terms of where it comes from, I'm sure it comes from somewhere, it originates somewhere in Eurasia. So many times these things have been hybridized and changed and stuff that, you know, the original origin of it is a long, is many, many hybrids and cultivars away.
A couple more things about the fire ant boiling mounds. I have a feeling people are about to go off on their fire ants. You said to hit the mound with your heel. What exactly does that do? Just stir them up, or
just to knock off the top of the, just to like to knock its cap off. So before you pour the boiling water in, so you have a more direct route to the bottom of the mound. That's what I meant.
And then next up we have, is it possible to protect wood siding against termites without poisoning that you know of?
I don't know.
Mm-hmm. That's a tough one.
That's a tough one, yeah. I'm going to say no, but I don't know.
How do I get rid of the big round holes that cicada killers create? I'm not sure if that plays into this conversation.
Mm-hmm. Well, that sounds like a natural phenomenon. So the cicadas are native. The cicada killers, I think, are native. So I'm not seeing the problem, really. So if that person explains, then I don't know. Otherwise, you would just fill the hole, I guess.
And then let's see. Last question so far in the chat is, I don't usually have mosquitoes because I drain all the standing water. I do have dragonflies, et cetera, in my yard.
Nice.
But this year, I seem to have a lot of mosquitoes. Any factor to that?
There's been wet, mm-hmm. You know, there's wet. There's standing water. I mean, not this summer so much, but obviously all spring long, it was wet. So there was a lot of mosquitoes, and there was a big, a lot of chiggers too at one point as well. And then they've kind of died off since it went dry. Central Texas after all.
Okay. Well, that finishes up all the questions there. So Audrey, if you had any closing, and I know you have some resources for the.
Yeah, thanks Jeremy for running that. And thank you to Darrell for the presentation. I've included those links in the chat. If you have any questions, you know, feel free to contact. I think you have Johanna's email from Travis County and my colleague Marissa's email from the city, so please feel free to reach out. And thank you so much again. We'll be back with another installment next month that we'll share with you then.
Okay, my thanks to you, Jeremy, well. And Audrey.
Thank you, Darrell.
Bye.
Take care, everybody.
Uh-huh.